So, we'll move on to perhaps the high point of Catherine Bigelow's career, Scott, with The Hurt Locker.
Yes, The Hurt Locker, in which Jeremy Renner's Sergeant First Class William James arrives in Iraq as a replacement bomb disposal expert. An opportunity opened up by Dead Man's Smouldering Boots, he joins Anthony Mackie's Sergeant J.T. Sanborn and Brian Geraghty's Specialist Owen Eldridge as they go about their extraordinary day-to-day activities of bomb disposal, which are anything but day-to-day. There's perhaps not all that much value in describing in great detail each of the bomb disposal vignettes that we see, as while each of them are quite excruciatingly tense experiences, they are as much there to gain an insight into the characters as they are to shed a light on the traumatic experiences of the soldiers undertaking this kind of work. A primary focus, of course, is on Renner's character, who seems like a reckless, thrill-seeking cowboy, and a large part of the success of the film is derived from his performance in taking us along as we try, and ultimately fail, to answer the question of why he's like this. Some people are just wired that way, it seems. On a second viewing, there's perhaps only disappointment in a film that is otherwise blindingly well executed. Nail-biting stuff, with a clutch of excellent performances in lead and supporting roles, and some impactful, explosive moments. Extraordinary stuff, and I think in the last decade only Sicario has come close to building the same level of tension that Hurt Locker does. I don't think I have a great deal of innovative or informative things to tell you about The Hurt Locker. It was many people's top film of 2009 or 2008, depending on how you count it, and I broadly agree. Required viewing, and also nice to see that it's one of the few films that seems to have turned a profit for Catherine Bigelow, who's not had an awful lot of success with films that really deserved much, much better than the box office values that they got in the final analysis. Hurt Locker, yes. I didn't belabor the point. I find it difficult to imagine that people haven't seen Hurt Locker. It's one of the most well-respected films of the past couple of decades, so if you haven't seen it, it's absolutely required viewing, and you should do so immediately. Just extraordinarily tense stuff, and probably the best performance from everyone involved, certainly Jeremy Renner, and probably Catherine Bigelow's best film. Just a quite extraordinary achievement in edge of the seat filmmaking.
Assuming that one of the Catherine Bigelow films I've not seen, and like suddenly, you know, the one with Sean Penn, it's like unexpectedly a masterpiece. Then it's comfortably her best film for me. I don't have a lot to add. It's so well made. It's so tense, and the characters are so believable too. And even the bits where it should be shocking, but the bit where Anthony Mackie's about to. Well, not about to, but considers blowing Jeremy Renner up.
Yeah. You think he could do it, actually, at that point.
Well, but you're also, you kind of sympathise.
Yes.
You can see why. It's not that he's between us. Like, he's going to get me killed. I may have to kill him first.
Yes.
So, yes, you can absolutely believe that. It's like a series of vignettes, and they're all fantastic. And there's, like, different levels of tension and stuff. I really, really enjoy it. I think the only thing about the film I actually don't like is that very small portion that's happening back in the United States. And it compared to the rest of the film, which does so much with so little, it feels so ham-fisted.
Yeah.
And it doesn't
fit. That's the one, I think, issue I took with it at the time, and it still sticks out now, particularly because there's one scene that tells you almost everything you need to know. And there's a scene just in front of his little monologue to his kid where he basically tries to explain his character in as much detail as you can in a couple of lines of dialogue, which seems to be the only reason it was shoehorned in. It didn't make a lot of sense to do it, because you get everything the same from the scene before, I think almost immediately before, when he's in the supermarket and he's looking at the aisle of cereal and he's looking one way down and sort of quizzically saying, why is all this crap here? And then up the other way, this infinite supply of frosted cereals of various things. It's like, you get everything you really need to know and everything that he says in that ham-fisted speech from just that look, and I don't understand why that thing. It feels like something that was shoehorned in, but it seems like a studio note, you know. I've no basis for that in fact or reality, but it just seems like the sort of thing that you would hold up as an example of, here's a studio sticking their oar in because they think you can't understand it.
This bit needs to be on the nose.
Yeah.
It's that whole thing I find ham-fisted though, that the ridiculous on those spelling out his inner thoughts to his kid is really bad. But I actually really dislike the supermarket scene as well, because I honestly got everything that tells you from the rest of the film.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
It just seems so, I'm not quite sure what the word is, not amateurish, but just so kind of crass to have him overwhelmed by the choice of serials as the showing how he's completely disconnected from the world and there's nothing there for him and not really understanding that world anymore or anything like that. It's like, yeah, I got that from all of the rest of the film.
Yeah.
You could have gone from like 2 days of Bravo Company, which is the last time you see them in Iraq, comes back, you see him at dinner preparing the food with Evangeline Lilly, and then just cut straight back to the Delta Company 365 days of their tour.
Yeah.
Like, all you needed was that one beat of going back in the United States. You see him back in Iraq and you immediately get everything without any of that ham-fisted stuff in between. And it's
true.
The only thing about that film I don't like. It kind of frustrates me because it's such a good film. It's like, it's just this tiny bit of tarnish in there that was not necessary. So, and I can absolutely see where you're coming from with it being like a studio note. That's like, feels like, oh, we need to explain this to people. Like, really?
Yeah.
But if you need that explaining, well, I think you're probably not the audience for this film, quite frankly.
Yeah, particularly because it doesn't really explain anything about Benner's character either. If you take the rest of the film as an attempt to explore his character and why he's doing the things he's doing and he's in that line of work that he is, what he says doesn't really explain it either, other than I like doing it, which, fine, okay, but it's not really much of a satisfying explanation of all things. It may well be true, and I'm happy to accept that, but I would almost prefer it being a bit more enigmatic rather than having to put through those scenes. But yes, we're picking nits, really. It shouldn't really focus on it. And just to clarify something I said earlier, because when I'm talking about these being vignettes, it does make it sound like it's not particularly well coherent. But it is. It all hangs together really well. And it's just obviously the nature of the job. There's not going to be one real overarching narrative going through it other than they are in Iraq trying to get rid of bombs. So, there's no slight intended in that. And it all works incredibly well.
Yeah, and also sort of different sets of tension as well.
Yeah.
Because you've got the sort of the potential of the bomb going off, and then like the potential for, like, particularly the last scene with the guy with the cage around him that's been locked on for the misunderstanding and stuff, and actually all the sympathy to. And then probably my favourite scene, the one with the sniper.
Yeah.
It's just so many good scenes in that film, and it's like different approaches to all the stuff they would have to do. And I know one of the criticisms at the time was that some of the things they do that they wouldn't have done, and people were getting a bit like territorial, I guess. And they're like, no, that this type of soldier would do this. Like,
yeah,
I get that, but it's a film, and like any film that shows any type of job of any sort, really, it's like it's quite often, especially something like the army, you're going to have like. It'd be very compartmentalised. One group of people would do the one thing, but you can't just show that because it would be like they would be doing this one tiny wee thing every day for lots of days. So you have to kind of combine it to one person. So it's not a valid complaint.
Yeah.
It's a film, and as long as how it's done is presented in a reasonably realistic way, even if it wouldn't be them that did that particular thing, then I think you're fine.
Yeah.
That's not the sort of thing that you hung up about on this. Anyway, yes, what we're saying is that it's very, very good, so you should watch it if you haven't.
Yes.
Do yourself a favour.